All right, if you're joining us in this video, we're going to be going over building an event flyer page. It looked like a real simple one. I don't know. Again, I haven't tested this out. If you're new to this channel, my name's Rob. I'm a coding instructor. This is freeCodeCamp, and we're working with freeCodeCamp's information that they have out there because we understand the struggle. It's real. And if you have somebody to help guide you along the way, then more power to you. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to go at this at an instructor's point of view. We're just going to do a little code along. And I will have everything chaptered out down below. What you can do to help us out is go ahead and like this video and make a comment on there if you want. But the like, definitely do, because you're gonna get something out of this. So let's go ahead and dive into the code. All right, again, and if this is your first time taking a look at this project or this video, what I typically like to do is do a real quick overview. And if I take a look at what we're going to be building out, it looks almost like a little Word document where we have an image here. It's centered. It looks like we have a horizontal rule. We have some things that might be bolded. I don't know. We're going to go through each one of these user stories. And again, how freeCodeCamp works this one here is there's not going to be step-by-step guidance. And again, that's why I'm making this video, is to help those that maybe need the step-by-step guidance. And we're going to go through each one of these user stories. I'm not going to test these as we go, but you most certainly can. You can pause that video and you can go ahead and test these things out, because when you run the test on it, we should be knocking these out. Usually they have these tests knocked out in order of user stories, so it does make it handy. You'll be able to see a check mark if it passes, and you'll see an X if it doesn't. Now, if I happen to do something on here, or I code something out and it's a mistake, we're going to correct it later on. And that's going to be chaptered down below as well. So it will typically be titled something like Fixing Our Mistakes. And you can go down there and visit that, but it will be chaptered out in the description here. So with that being said, let's go ahead and start off with our user story number one. So user story number one, real simple. It says that you should have a header element within the body. So we're going to come down here to the body and we're going to apply it. So let's go ahead and do the header and let's close that off as well. And I'm always telling students, whenever we are making a tag, let's go ahead and make a closing tag as well on here. So that way we don't forget, because sometimes we want to move on to the next story before we complete this part here. So good practice. Wherever you have an opening one, let's make a closing one where possible. All right, that should satisfy user story number one. User story number two, it says your header element should have an image in it for the event and an H1 for the event title. And you can utilize this image if you would like. So we will use our image. I don't know if they're utilizing the same one for the rock festival, but we will see what they give us. So the very first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and do an image tag. Now, I'm always telling you, hey, wherever we have open, let's go ahead and close it. But image tags are a little different. They are called void elements. It does not get a closing tag. We can go ahead and put one of these on here, and it will be what we call like self-closing. Next thing on here, we do need to provide a source on our image. And then we're going to call this one, this URL that we have right here. So let me go ahead and make sure I grab and I'm going to paste it right there. So we should see something like this, which is flag. So totally not a rock festival. And maybe this would be a flag festival. But anyways, next we're going to add an H1 to the bottom of this and it will be below it. So I'm going to go ahead and do this, do H1. And in here, we're going to do flag festival. Perfect. So that is satisfying. User story number two, I'm sure we're going to be styling this here in some other user stories, but it just wants to give us a real quick outline first. So we're looking at user story number three. It says that we should have a main element within the body. All right, another quick one, but where does this go in the hierarchy? So all these unique tags that we're using, which are header and main, those are semantic elements. They really don't do anything to us visually, but it helps break apart the page into different sections. And so I'm going to give myself some space here, and just to help organize this, I'm going to go ahead and type the word main. It needs to be outside of the header, but part of the body. And then we're going to close that off there. And that's really all that's needed for satisfying that user story number three, where we just need to add a main element to the body. All right. Let's move on to the next user story. User story number 4 seems like a real simple one. It says that your main element should have at least 2 section elements within its showcasing of the event features. So what it's asking for here is I'm going to click in between the main. I'm going to hit the enter key a couple times here just to give ourselves some space. And the very first thing that I want to do is a section, and then I'm closing it off. And I'm just going to highlight that, copy that, and we'll paste it down here. So now we have the 2 sections on there, and we can kindly see that we have, as far as the hierarchy goes, the main element is wrapping the 2 sections. Because if I'm able to click on this little triangle here that we see, then I'm collapsing and the sections should go away, right? So here we go. I believe that will satisfy user story number 4. User story number 5 in building an event flyer page for freeCodeCamp, it says that your section elements should each have an H2 within them. Let's go ahead and do that. So in our section here, I'm going to go ahead and hit the enter key, and I'm going to apply an H2 and then close it all. And inside of the H2, I'm just going to put in here something about the flag festival, just so that we have some text up here to show. So I'm just going to do special events, and then I'm going to copy this, and I'm going to come down to the next section, and I'm just going to paste what we just created up above. And instead of special events, maybe we can put in here prizes for everyone. Perfect. I believe that satisfies user story number 5. All right, so finally we're getting into some styling here with user story number 6. It says that your body should have a top and bottom padding of 50 pixels. So one of the first things that we need to do is we need to open up our styles.css. What I always like to tell my students is that let's test to make sure that we can even add anything to this CSS-wise. And the easiest way to do this is test out the body. And when we do this, I'm going to choose a background color, and I'm going to change it to pink. Now, what I would expect is the background color to be pink. However, that's not the case here. Why is this not working? That's the question that we need to ask, right? Is why is it not working? So what I would do is, we kind of get a hint right here, is be sure you link your style sheet HTML to your CSS. In all my videos that I do, I'm always telling people, hey, it's really good to Google things, go take a look at things, but it's also how to Google. And so what I would do is Google, how do I add CSS and then W3 school? And it will populate with something that looks like this, and where we have 3 ways. And the way that we're going to use is this one right here. I have it highlighted for us, where I'm going to go ahead and copy this and paste it into our section. It needs to go into the head section. So let's go back here and let's apply this to the head. Now, it doesn't matter where it goes. Typically, I'll put it right here at the end of the title. And notice that it's still not working. Well, that's because it's looking for a style sheet named mystyle.css. FreeCodeCamp doesn't give us the option to alter the name of this, so we have to go with styles. So if we change this to styles and we're linking it, now we see the pink. And so that's how we're going to link this to our page here. So now we can go ahead and continue on with the user story number 6, because we need this to be 50 pixels from the top and bottom padding. And so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to do padding top, and we're going to set this to 50 pixels, and then we'll do padding bottom and set that to 50 pixels as well. And I believe that should satisfy user story number 6. And we'll go ahead and keep this pink background for demo purposes, because I may want to show you a few things on what we can do with this. All right, so let's go ahead and move on to the next part. User story number 7 says the body should have a top and bottom margin of 0, while the left and right will need to center itself. So this might be a tricky one, again, if you're maybe just diving into this, but they talked about how do we center items on a div when it comes to margins, and that's going to be utilizing the keyword of auto for the left and right margins. So because we have values that FreeCodeCamp is giving us for all sides, we can encompass this with one property for CSS, and that's going to be margin. Now, the way that this is going to work, because the top and bottom margins are the same value, they want it to be 0, we can get by utilizing the shortcut on the margin property of just supplying two values. Top and bottom, they're going to get zero margin. Next is the left and right. How do we do that? Remember, I said we want to utilize the keyword of auto, and then we'll put the semicolon there. So that is what's going to give us the zero for the top and bottom, and then the left and right margins that center themselves, and that's going to be the auto. User story number 8, it says that your body should have a width set relative to the width of the viewport. But before I go and do this, I am going to do something here for us, just as a real quick teaching point. I'm going to create an outline. And this outline, I'm going to set to 1 pixel solid red. And we can see that it is just going around the body element right now. And let me go ahead and pop this out, and maybe we can see it a little better. Because what this box represents is the body, the div element of the body. And we have added padding to the top and to the bottom. And that's why you see this space right here on the bottom, and you have space on the top. Now, what it's asking us to do is change the view width. And it wants us to alter the width by utilizing the viewport. And so how are we going to do that? I'm going to come over here to the CSS page, and I'm going to go ahead and type in width. And this is what makes it a little dynamic when we're talking about maybe responsiveness, but we want the view width of the browser. And so now if I take a look at this, notice that we have this little bounding box, and it's using 90% of the view width. And right now it is centered because of our margin zero and auto. That's what's causing this to be centered like this. And if I change the view here, notice that I still maintain that type of ratio here where it's eating up 90% of the view width. What if I were to change this to 20? And this is the part where I always tell the students, hey, explore with some of these values while you're going through some of these exercises, because it will help you potentially understand a few things of what's going on. Again, notice that I have shrunk my view width. Now it's 20%. It is always centered. We get to a point where everything's just overflowing outside of the width boundary, and images, until we tell it to be 100% of the parent, it's always going to overflow or go outside of the borders. But anyways, I just wanted to show that to you when we're using this. Let me go ahead and bring the preview back here normally, and I will get rid of outline, and I will put this at 90. All right, and let's see if that satisfies that one. It sure does, and we're moving on to the next section here. User story number 9, it says the body should utilize the calc function, and this should be that video that you just watched just prior to this one, if you're going along with the Free Code Camp's lesson, where he talks about how calc is a function and we can provide it some values here. And so how do we use that in this respect? So it wants us to come in here and do a minimum height, and it wants us to set to the calc function. Now the calc function looks like this, C-A-L-C, all lowercase. We're gonna do left and right parentheses in here. Now we're going to put something in here. We'll say 100%, and it's going to be of the view height, because we're talking about height, and then we're going to subtract 100 pixels. And I believe this should work out for what is needed here. In the video, and I'm gonna bring this up here, and I'm gonna get rid of the index, that there's spaces they need to be there, meaning that we can't have something like this and have it work. It needs to be a space in between here. And so basically it's going to say, hey, the minimum height that you're going to be is 100% of the view height that we get, but then we're going to take away 100 pixels. So it shrinks it up like that. So that's what that one would do. And I believe that is exactly what we need to do for this. And let's go ahead and move on to the next section here. Oh, and I did want to bring up that point here as I was closing off from this section. is the padding. So it's going to be the height minus the padding applied to the top and bottom. And so if we come over here, we did 50 on the top, 50 on the bottom, 50 plus 50 is 100, which is where we came up with this value. All right, so user store number 10, it tells us that we need to have at least one HR on our flyer. So let's go back to our index.html, and I'm going to come down here, and below the header, I'm going to go ahead and do an HR. So we'll do an HR. We can see that line came through, and I believe in the next user story, we're going to be going back to the CSS and applying a width to it. So let's go ahead and mark this one as complete, and we're moving on to the next user story. So user story number 11, we need to set the width of all of our HRs to a percent value relative to the parents. What does that mean? We're going to come over here to our styles. We're going to do HR, and then we want the width. Let's go ahead and change that to maybe 80%. And I believe that is what it is looking for. So you can see how it did shrink. Here's what it was before. Here's after. You can see that it did, in fact, shrink there. So that is user story number 11. Now it's time for testing. Okay, so this is the part where I kind of get nervous because I don't know if I did everything correctly, but I'm hoping that I did. I'm going to go ahead and run through these tests. And we didn't see the confetti, which is unfortunate, but let's see which one we messed up on. The width of the section elements should be utilizing a percent value. So let's go ahead and knock out the widths of these sections as well. So for that, I'm going to come over here. I'm going to do section, and then I'm going to open up the curly brackets. And it really wants the almost the exact same thing here. I'm going to do width, and we'll do 49%. Hopefully that is what it is looking for. Again, we're not going to see anything visually, but we should get the confetti now. All right, perfect, great. We did it. Yeah, so we did do it, right? Yay. But I felt like this one kind of a little bit of a disappointment when it came to, hey, this is what we're going to show you to make. And then we just have this short little user case one here. So I don't know if this one happens to be in beta or not, but as of right now, in order to pass this, that's all we had to do. It's nothing that I would be proud of doing when it comes to the FreeCodeCamp stuff that at least this lab or this workshop has us doing. So hopefully other ones will be better, but make sure you like and subscribe to these videos. We're going to keep on doing them to help you get better with your learning. All right, see you in the next one.